You're still there. You're always with us. And that man and everyone else, family and friends, will always sadly let us down, even when they try as hard as they can. But you're the only one who won't. You see the finish line. You see the end result. And you know what's best for us. Help us to remember that. Help us to lean and focus on you. Give the speaker the words tonight, dear Lord. As she speaks, we heard some of her story, and we know that she loves you and she's on fire for you as well. But give us the hearts and the ears to listen tonight. In your precious name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.
All right, let's give it up one more time. That's amazing. I was told I was coming up here. I don't have to be. Although I'm short, so I like to be tall when I can. Because my husband is 6'3", and I'm 5'2". So that's a picture of us right there. Don't we look stellar? I think we look pretty stellar. It's interesting, as I prepared for today, I always think about what I do on a daily basis. So I'm a high school teacher. Yeah, that's right. So be kind to your teachers, please, all right? How many of you here are freshmen? Yeah, all right, welcome. I spend all day with you guys. I do. Not you in particular, of course, but people just like you. And I enjoy it. It has been a long journey in getting to where I am now. And part of that comes, and part of my love for it comes from my own journey. And so, you know, it says up there, who I am now is not who I was. And, you know, I thought about this, and people are like, well, yeah, you're brilliant. Of course not. I'm not even the same person today that I was yesterday. I haven't grown at all, but I certainly change, right? We change. People impact us, and they change our life. You know, it was interesting listening to these songs. You know, I prepare a message, and then the Holy Spirit does these really incredible things when you get forward in front of people, and he kind of goes, I'm going to tell you what to say. And I've learned over the course of my life thus far that you are obedient to the Holy Spirit when he tells you to go. So, you know, just come along with me. I grew up in the church. My parents were actually missionaries. And so by all accord, I would be like the golden child, right? And I grew up in church. My parents, my grandparents, we all went to the same church. My parents traveled over to South America, and we were there for a while. And so I've heard the Jesus loves me stories. I've heard all of that my whole life. And then it became really clear when my family was falling apart that what happened to this Jesus that loves me? And what happens if I get saved and now it's all going to be roses and fairies? What happened to this story? That wasn't my story. That wasn't what was going on in my house. And it was hard to start getting hard to go to church. It started getting hard to wake up in the morning on Sunday and not argue with my mother. And here's the thing. Back then, it was inappropriate to wear pants to church, my mother would say. So, skirts, dresses, hosiery. And when you're 12 and 13, that is not what you want to wear, okay? And so it was like one excuse that I could give my mom, and we'd battle every Sunday morning. And, you know, it was really interesting war we were having. While my brother was kind of just like, whatever, wake me up when it's time to go. And it got to the point, right, where it just wasn't enough anymore. The stories weren't enough anymore. The God that you were all telling me about seemed to not really exist in my house and in my life. And you're going to have to do a heck of a lot more to convince me at this point that I'm loved, because it really doesn't feel like I'm loved at all. Now, you can tell I have my own style. And this has been a long time developing. And I was the girl who wore the thing that nobody ever wore and, like, owned that. I owned that. I had these great purple velour pants. They were made fun of all the time, man. I wore them just so they could make fun of me because I liked them so much. And when I was about 15 years old, I decided to shave my head. And it was not popular like it is now. That was not popular. My mother was not very happy with me. And, right, I was trying to find my identity. I was trying to find out who I was. Because at the end of the day, people were starting to label me. Oh, that's the girl you don't want in class. You know, the teacher would look down the roster and go, I don't want that one. I don't want that one. I'd go to youth group and I'm like, please don't put Lindsay in my small group. I don't want her. She's weird and loud and she says weird things. Right? So bottom line was I was trying to find out who I was. See, if I'm created by God, why am I so messed up? I don't really understand. Why is my life the way that it is? And the thing is, all of those things are true. God does love us, and God did create us, but it was not real to me. Somebody needed to make it real. It needed to become something more than just these Bible stories and pay your tithe and go home and just do whatever we're doing, because my life around me was crumbling. Now, I spend all day with people, and this world is crumbling. And it's crumbling. We're crumbling with it because we haven't quite figured out who it is we're supposed to be. So, you know, over the last few years, the Lord has called me into speaking, but partly because, right, I felt like I was nothing. I felt like I could be no one, that I could never be good enough. never going to be good enough. Never going to be smart enough. I'm never going to be pretty enough. Never going to be tall enough. Never going to be sure enough. Never going to be, never going to be, never going to be. I mean, that's what our world tells us, isn't it? I mean, my kids are doing finals right now. We're at the end of the semester. And, finals ended at 11, and at noon I was getting an email, what's my grade, what's my grade? I was like, well, you should wait. Let me get creative. Here's the thing, right? All of those things are important, but they're not who you are. See, one of the greatest battles that we will face is the one for our hurt. The world is after your heart. And if you give it, it's real hard to get it back. And the problem is that when we say, I'm not good enough, I'm not smart enough, I'm not tall enough, I'm not skinny enough, I'm not fast enough, the world is getting just a little bit of us. You see, there's a scripture that was laid on my heart for this particular time, and I think about it often, because this is not something that we were ever told when we were kids. We were not told this, and I guess there's probably a good reason for it, but I think to myself, we should have been told that we were somebody's prey. And so the scripture that I have for you guys today is 1 Peter 5:8. And it should come up on the screen. Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. So the thing is, when we start to identify with the world, when we start to accept the identities that are given to us, I was given plenty of them, right? You're too loud, you're obnoxious, you're ugly, right? You're this, you're that. When we start to say, yeah, I guess you're right, I am. Yeah, I guess you're right, yep. All the teachers, they were ready for me to be bad before I even came in the room. And so the tip I give to teachers now is don't do that, because they will be bad. As soon as I knew the teacher that was waiting for me, they were in trouble. Because the thing is, right, we give what we're given. We give it back. And the devil loves it when we do it, because it's a little bit more of you. The message really comes down to the fact that you are someone's prey. And yes, we hear about it on the news and we hear this, but the thing is there's someone after your heart. They're after your heart. See, sin is a part of our internal structure. Like, it's a part of who we are. Our greatest problem, though, is trying to tackle it with our own willpower and our own determination. See, I knew there were things that I needed to fix. I knew I needed to fix my attitude. I needed to fix the friends I was hanging out. I knew all those things. But I wasn't going to give in to letting God help me do that. Come on now. I can do it by myself. I'm strong enough. I'm brave enough. Come on, I shaved my head for goodness sakes. I can do this. Right? That's the thing though, that the devil loves it when we think we can do it all by ourselves. Because when he knows that you can do it, oh yeah, you can. Of course you can. Listen, those people are great. You should hang out with them more often. Oh yeah, just forget about the fact that you got arrested last weekend, because that doesn't matter. You can forgive them. They didn't mean it when they talked behind your back, right? The thing is that the labels or the faces you put on every day that are not you is the way the devil comes prowling. Every time you feel like you have to put on a face that isn't you, is the devil taking a little bit more and a little bit more. Ironically enough, like I stand here and talk to you about identity, it wasn't until probably 2 years ago that I realized that has been my greatest feat. I gave my heart over to the Lord when I was 19 years old, and I have battled to give the rest of me over. Because the thing is that we have to let go. We have to not be in control. See, but the more room you put between you and your Creator, the more room you leave for the world to impact you. So So the greater distance you make between you and the one who created you. So every time you believe the lie, every time you do something that you know you shouldn't, you put this distance. And that lion is prowling. And he likes it. And he's going to convince you that you're doing the right thing, right? See, here's the thing. If you feel alone and you feel isolated, that's right where the devil wants you. Because if I can't hear my creator, I'm waiting for another voice. I'm waiting for that thing to tell me that, you know what? God gave up on you a long time ago. You know how many times I've heard that? You know how many times, right? You're not good enough. Don't even bother asking for forgiveness again. You've hit your quota. We do that, don't we? We do that. We do that. And guess who that is? It's the lion. Right? He's prowling around. I love the imagery there. And I love this, the word relentless that came out of this song, because here's the thing. You have this lion prowling around for you, and then you have this relentless Lord that's ready to wipe him out. Ready. Ready and willing. See, we can feel ourselves getting backed into a corner. It happens, right? You can feel it. And you can choose two things. You can either fight or flight. Now, it's going to shock you. I know, it shocks all my students too. I got myself backed into a few corners a few times. When you're little, people think they can pick on you. And I remember I was 8th grade. And my brother said, I'm tired of fighting for you. So, you need to learn how to fight. Okay, so what, 12 years old? And my brother says, it's time for you to learn how to fight. Okay. And so, you know, he's telling me, because I was bullied relentlessly. I mean, I was shoved in a locker. Yep, been there. Shoved in a locker. I've had people spit on me. I've been pushed downstairs. I've had it. And my brother just said, you got to stick up for yourself. You got to. Okay, fine. So he teaches me how to fight. Well, then I just become this, like, relentless Tasmanian devil in freshman year. What'd you say to me? What'd you say to me? Right? I was like ready. I was like, my brother taught me what to do. I'm ready. The thing was is that at the end of the day, when I would sit down or I'd go to Wednesday night church or I'd go to Sunday church, there's just this ball, right? Because I'm hearing all these messages, and I know that they're probably true because I believe you, you're the pastor, they wouldn't have put you up there if you didn't know what you were talking about. But that's not how I feel. I don't feel like anyone loves me. I don't feel like I was created by something amazing. This world's telling me I'm not. This world keeps picking on me. So I was angry with God. We don't talk about that very often, do we? I was angry. I spent a lot of time yelling at God. The truth was, is that there was a spiritual battle happening every single time. Do you understand that? Do you understand that there's a spiritual battle for your heart every minute of the day? Because the Creator wants nothing more for you to fall in love with Him, because He already is madly in love with you. But then the devil has got a way of finding his way in. See, some of us have built up walls so high by now, right, that every identity that you've been given, it would take a wrecking ball to take it down. And for some of us, that's exactly what it's going to take, is a wrecking ball. What's particularly sneaky about the devil is he likes to disguise things in fun times. Oh, wasn't that so fun? Wasn't that great? The truth is that you know in your heart it wasn't a whole lot of fun. And those people, they're probably not really friends. I realized about my junior year or so, when I had a lovely meeting with the assistant principal and my mother, that the assistant principal, you know, pulled out the, you know, all the things you've seen in the cartoons, like they happen. Like a big file came out on the desk, and my mother just shook her head because my brother had a file twice the size of mine. And there was no cell phones then, by the way, either. My mother's rule was that you had to call her before the principal called her. So I had to deal with the principal that he would give me a quarter, and then I would run down to the payphone, and he would give me the minute to like run down the hall to the payphone and put it in and be like, "Ma, he's gonna call you. Okay, what'd you do?" Oh, okay. And then I'd hang up the phone, I'd run back, and then he'd call, and she'd be, "Yeah," she told me. Okay, what's gonna happen? Out of school suspension, in school suspension, what? The assistant principal said, "One more fight. One more. And we're done." I was going into my senior year. I knew what I wanted to do. I knew I wanted to be a teacher. I know it sounds really weird. Why would I want to be a teacher? I wanted to be a teacher. I wanted to be a teacher because, you know what, frankly, I had all these teachers who treated me so bad, and I was like, dude, I'm going to go up there and show them how it's done. And here's the thing, right? I was like, but I have this plan, and like, I know I can be better than this, and shoot, man, one more fight, I'm done? Well, I can't do any of those things if I'm out. So my senior year was all about changing, right? I'm going to change. No, I'm going to change. The thing was, right, I wanted to do it all by myself. I figured I could change myself all by myself. I got myself in this mess. I can get myself out. My graduating class was 1,300 people. The high school I went to had 5,000 people in it. It now has almost 7,000 people in it. Try eating lunch alone in the lunchroom when there's 600 people around you. And that was me my senior year. It became a really dark place for me, right? Because here I am trying to be better, but it feels so lonely. And I couldn't figure out why. I couldn't figure out, if I'm going to be better, why am I so alone? I mean, that's what we ask ourselves, right? When we want to take that leap of faith. Well, wait, if I'm going to do this and I'm going to live this life, why do I feel so lonely? Well, we got to shake that guy off. The thing was, so I sat alone, got picked on, right? Kind of like went back a few years. Oh, look at her. She thinks she's going to be so good. Oh, I wanted to. Yeah. I have one more fight. One more fight. Okay. See, some of you think right now, you know what, that's all nice, Lindsay, but like, listen, I'm having a good time. I'm having a good time. The thing is, I would ask you, do you want peace in your life? You want hope? You want love? Can't have any of those. This world will pretend like it will offer you all of those. It doesn't have any. I know that sounds like an all or nothing kind of thing, right? But it's true. I've been out there a little bit. And I watch my students, and I watch even my own colleagues, and they wander around looking for peace and hope and love, and they're not going to find it. Not here. Real peace, real hope, and real love come when you fall in love with the person that created you. That's where real peace comes from. That whole senior year was miserable, man. I mean, not to mention that I was the senior in the freshman math class, but you got big bricks. You play, you got big bricks. God can't get you out of that one, okay? But here's the thing, right? I kept trying to find it all by myself. And I did it for a little while. But I knew that if I really didn't want to slip back into the life that I used to live, if I didn't want to go back to doing the things that I was doing, something had to change. What I particularly love about the scripture in 1 Peter is that, you know, if you look at scripture all by itself, it seems kind of scary. You know, like, okay, you're coming here telling me that this lion is prowling around looking for me. Okay. But here's the wonderful thing about this scripture, this wonderful thing about our Heavenly Father, is that in verse 7, so just before he warns us, he says, "Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you." Now, about you, I mean, I love my husband. We've been married for 10 years. We've been together for 17. Before him, though, I had a few friends. And like many of you, you probably heard, "I care for you. I love you. then I'm going to tweet how I hate you, and then we're going to be broke up. Right? You've heard, I care for you, I love you in all different kind of worldly ways. This is not that. This is something that you can only experience by being completely obedient. And then feel how he wraps his arms around you. Because then, in verse 9, right after he warns us about the lion, he then tells us, stand firm against him and be strong in your faith. It's like a step-by-step on how to take a walk with Christ. But you know what? It starts in our very own weakness. That's where it starts. I don't know about you, but days are long and trouble comes. I would have liked to think that, you know, I get saved and then I'll move on and my life will be so dandy, right? The older we get, the more problems we get. Problems are just different, right? Now I gotta pay bills and I gotta, you know, wake up and go to work, and right? The thing is, at the end of the day, verse 7 still rings true. Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you. He cared about me. When the devil was prowling around saying, don't ask for forgiveness again because you're not going to get it. He's had enough of you. He doesn't love you. Because guess what? We all hear it. Don't listen to that voice. That's not God. When you feel worried and anxious, you feel isolated and alone, not God. It's not. This world's going to sell you peace that doesn't exist. It doesn't. Which is why sometimes we falter, right? Because we don't realize that that creator, the Jesus, he's going to grab you, and then he's going to lift you up so you can be victorious. I went to my 10-year class reunion. Boy, was that a trip. And it was a bunch of people reminding me of the person I used to be. And I quickly said, we need to go. I'm not that person. I don't know about you, but maybe you've hit a place where you just don't want to be that person anymore. That person's just not fun. It looks like fun. Everybody's laughing. Everybody seems to be having a good time. When you look in the mirror, you don't see you. You certainly don't see the you you want to be. See, the devil looks at your weakness as an opportunity to devour you. We're just afraid to admit that we're weak, aren't we? The devil likes to keep you that way. Your heavenly Father looks at your weakness as the time to make you divine. Your weakness is an opportunity to be devoured or an opportunity to rise above. I want you to think about it in this way. So collision with the devil. So when we collide with the devil, there's a few things that come out of it. Anger, self-hate, frustration, and loneliness. That's what happens when we collide with the devil. If you felt those things, you're in a spiritual battle. He's vying for your heart. The devil wants you, right? And that, he breaks you so you can stay broken. And he will keep coming. I'm so thankful that I know the Heavenly Father. I'm so thankful that I've been saved from my sins. I'm so thankful, and he still comes. He doesn't stop. Because he breaks you to be broken. Here's the thing, though, you want to collide with God? You get love, acceptance, peace, and freedom. You're broken to be healed. See, Christ didn't die on the cross so that you could continue to be someone's prey. He died on the cross so you could be free. Now, there are a lot of people, I'm sure if I ran into people, they'd say, you're doing what? Lindsay, you're doing what? What do you talk about? Please, please. I can hold my head high because the only identity I wear now is the one that is loved. You can wear a lot of faces. We all do. But if you want to wear the one that brings upon peace and hope
and love. It's a label of love. So here's 2 Corinthians 12:9. My grace is all you need. My power works best in your weakness. What I love most about that, look at that. The devil is after you when you're weak. Your Heavenly Father, he gets to rise and be powerful in your weakness. The grace of God is unearned and unearnable. You do not have to do anything to earn it. You do not have to better yourself before you get him. You can come to him today. That's it. I always thought that too. You know, I got to stop smoking. I got to stop swearing. I got to stop hanging out with that guy over there. And then maybe God will want me. No, he wants you just like this. Dirty, messed up, and broken. I promise you. I promise you. I was trying to dig up pictures of myself so you'd believe me while I'm telling you right now. I am broken. I was broken. This world broke me so they could keep me, and then Jesus saved me so I could be healed and then speak of his power. And he wants each one of you to be able to do the same thing, to rise above what this world has called you and be able to say, no, I am called the son or daughter of Christ. Take that. See, are you heavy today? Do you walk in here saying, man, I'm so sick and tired of having to be fake to that person and fake to that person and fake to that person. I just really want to be real. Whatever real is, are you out of solutions? I sat in that meeting with that principal. I was out of solutions. My mom was out of solutions. The thing was, is that, you know, we can try and try and try with all our might. You might be stubborn. You might be bold. You can be so much more if you fall madly in love with the one who already loves you. Have you done all you can? Are you tired of carrying the weight of this world? I look every day around me, and I see students that look just like me who are trying to carry it all. Their parents' problems, their problems, grades, drama, whatever it is. I watch it all day long, and then you know what? Let's just be honest, adults. We carry it around too, don't we? We all do. But when we know that we're loved, I can go at the end of the day and look at that and say, my grace is all you need. Okay, God. My power works best in your weakness. I'm weak. Lift me up. Make me strong. I want you guys to walk away just to think about something. We get a million labels all day long. You know, new semester is going to start for me. I love to hear what kids say to me when they meet me for the first time. I love, I listen. Oh, well, she's meaner than I thought. You know, it's usually what they think. The thing is, I just know that I'm loved, and because I'm loved, I can love them back. God wants you to know that you're loved. God wants you to know that you are in a place, no matter where you are, he's there. And he's calling out to you. He was calling out to me all that time. I just wasn't listening. Because the devil was after me. If you're tired of being proud now, if you're tired of the person you see in the mirror every day, there is a solution. It's not going to change the world you're in. It's just going to change the way you look at it. It didn't change my circumstances. It still doesn't. It just changes the way I look at those circumstances. If you're ready to be able to wake up in the morning and want to wake up, because I've been there too, there's a solution. So here's what I learned a while ago. A way to pray. So I'm a real audible prayer. I speak out loud to my God. It's just the kind of person I am. And some of us like to keep our prayers inside. What's really important to me, though, is that you know that you can worship your God. You can worship God however you want.
You can be down on your knees. You can be laying on the floor. You can be jumping up and down. You can worship God however you want because He rejoices in it all. So if you'll stand with me. I want you to put your hands out with your palms down. And close your eyes. Here's the thing. This is a representation of letting something go. I don't know what you walked in here with today. I know I walked in with my own thing. We all do, right? Sometimes we're on a high, sometimes we're on a low, sometimes we're right in the middle. But with your hands down, I want you to let something go. Maybe it's something real big. You know, for me, for a long time, I hung on to my parents' divorce for a really long time. And at one point, finally, God said, let that go. I hang on to my brother's alcoholism. Let it go. God, man, that girl calls me dumb and ugly every day. Let it go. I'm never going to be as fast as him. Let it go. For whatever it is that you're hanging on to is simply the devil prowling around, trying to keep you to hang on to that identity. Lord, I just ask now that you release. You allow us to release. You give us the privilege of releasing the baggage that we don't want to carry anymore. That with our hands down, we're just saying, you know what, devil? I don't got time for you. Because I'm letting this go. For everything that we let go, Lord, I know that you begin to fill it up with a tag called loved. For every time we say, I don't accept that, because I'm a child of God, I don't accept that, I'm a child of God, I don't accept that, and you get all the praise and glory, and the devil goes running. For he knows he has no place there. If you feel like it, say it. Say what you're letting go. Maybe you're going to let go of worry. Maybe you're going to let go of anxiety. But take a minute and let the Holy Spirit tell you what to let go of today. For there is no better time than right now. Now turn your hands up. This is the best part. This is the part where the Holy Spirit wants to fill you. This is the best part. You know what? The devil will take and take and take and take and take. He doesn't fill. God fills. So now let him fill in that spot you just let go. Because we're real quick sometimes to pick things back up, aren't we? Okay, Lord, I want to let that go. And then, as soon as something happens, we pick it right back up again. So let him fill that space. Let him fill the space with him. With the identity of loved. Lord, I thank you so much for today. Really, I thank you for every day. For I know times are dark. And the world would like to own us. But each one of us walked into here today as a child of God. May we walk out today believing it. May we know. And as the band plays, I want you just to be an attitude of prayer. I want you to know that the Lord is here. And if you will let him, he will speak to you. Take the walls down. Call out to him. Release the identities that don't belong to you. The world will tell you a great many things. Know that in your weakness, he is strong. If you are weak today, let him be strong for you.
Thank you.
ecstasy of the sweetest of love. When my heart comes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill me. There's nothing worth more that can ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living bone. Your presence, tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Sing out time.
The high feels real good, but the low feels real bad. It's like I tell so many people, right? If you want to get off that hamster wheel, where you kind of go high and low and high and low, and you're doing it all by yourself all the time, there's only one step. That's just to say, Lord, I can't do it anymore. I can't do it. I don't want to do it. So if that's you, while we worship some more, that altar is open. It's always open. Your chair is open. It's open. You don't have to follow any rules. When it comes to falling in love, madly with Christ, there are no rules. You just relentlessly let go, and He will relentlessly love you. That's the best part. So if that's you, the altar is open. It's open for every single person in this room. And if it's just about letting go over and saying, Lord, I'm done, I've hit my end, and I don't want to do it anymore like this because I'm not going anywhere, then let that be your call, because He hears each one of you. He will hear you, He will love you, and He will walk with you. All you have to do is say, take me. I'm yours. I'm yours. Mold me. Make me. I'll do whatever you need me to do, because, Lord, this world has nothing to offer, and I need peace, and I need hope, and I need love. So the altar is open to you. Please, please don't be afraid to come and worship Him this way.
fun tonight? Have you had a good time? As well, and one thing that what's super funny is Lindsay, I'm just gonna be honest, I forgot your name for a second. You know how you meet so many people and then you're like, hey, and the speaker is coming. That's usually a sign that I don't know somebody's name, like the speaker. But here's the really horrible, horrible part. My wife's name is Lindsay. So I feel really, really dumb. I'm just gonna be honest with you. Didn't she do awesome tonight? Did y'all enjoy it? Share from their heart. And here's the deal. When you have Jesus, there's no better excitement than having Jesus Christ in your heart. Everything else, it might feel that way for just like a fraction of a second. But when you really, truly experience Jesus, like that's it, man. That's the top. So we're going to do one song that's like celebratory, right? It's a celebration song. Can we do that to kind of end the night celebrating? Okay, but you got a part, okay? So I will say, I feel alive, and you will sing, I feel alive, right? Then I'll say, for the first time, guess what you'll say? For the first time. Do not say for the second time. It gets very confusing. Don't do that to us, okay? So I feel alive, for the first time, for the first time. If you want to jump, if you want to dance, this is the time to do it, all right? Can we do this thing?
Yeah!
I kind of believed it, like a little bit, I believed it. Can we do this thing? Let's do it. We gotta clap a little bit too, right? Oh, So here's what we have to say, or else the younger people in the band get mad at me. Whatever form of social media exists, we have a page. Twitter, Instagram, now Snapchat. That's Jed's favorite, right? So follow us, like us, all that stuff. If you took any pictures tonight, tag yourself. We'd love to stay in contact with you. Hey, where is Jody at? Where are you at?
Right here.
Where are you? Could we give her, wait, let me explain it real quick. She reached out to us on Facebook and said, we're coming to Spring Hill, and could you just give us some of the worship songs that y'all are doing so our kids can start learning them? I was like, that's awesome. Can we play at your church? So if you hated us, it's her fault. If you liked us, it's also her fault. So give her, thanks for that. Can we give her a round of applause? Tonight. But back behind the booth, can you give Matt a round of applause? We actually met at Spring Hill. We taught music and stuff, so we, like, once she said this is the church we were coming to, he's like, I know that joker. So he's helped us tonight with making everything sound good. Thank you again. Oh, that last part, I forgot. And remember, and stolen man.
Like the money.
CD. What?